The Lord bless you. I want to welcome you to a week and a day of change. One impression that God is laying in my heart is that each one of us must mark where we are as at today, because it's going to be the least that we will ever be in life. Each time God wants to do something great in the life of his people, he calls an assembly together and he sends his word unto them in order to bring them into the place of blessing. God has given us a charge, you know, to talk about this, the covenant keeping God in the course of this week, and to outline some of the things that his covenant will provoke into our life. In Exodus chapter 23, when we read from verse 25, when God gave us this message, he gave that particular passage of the scripture that is going to be where we're going to be treating. Now, the combination of things that were put together in that passage of the scripture that he wants to bring to manifestation in our life. Exodus 23 from verse 25, he said, "And ye shall serve the Lord your God, and he shall bless thy bread and thy waters, and I will take sickness away from the midst of thee. There shall nothing cast their young, nor be barren in the land. The number of thy days I will fulfill. I will send my fear before thee, and I will destroy all the people to whom thou shalt come, and I will make all thy enemies turn their back unto thee. And I will send hornets before thee, which shall drive out the Hivites, the Canaanites, and the Hittites from before thee. I will not drive them out from before thee in 1 year, lest the land become desolate and beasts of the field multiply against thee." Let me just stop there this evening. When you look at that passage and you look at the passage we just read, you find a number of things there. The promises that God made, and it shows the covenant that he has made with man and what he intends to do. I will, you know, he said, he will bless your bread and your water. That is prosperity. He will take sickness away from you. That is healing. He said, you will not cast your young nor barren. That is fruitfulness. He said, the numbers of your day you will fulfill. That is longevity or long life. He said, I will send your fear, my fear before you against your enemy. That is victory. So with me, you will always be winning. Now, in the course of this meeting, we will look at each of this promise of God, one after the other. Now, I was prepared to jump into number one when the Spirit of God called my attention back into the first statement there. Now, because each time you talk about covenant, it is something that connects two people together, a mutual agreement between two people, something that brings a link, you know, an agreement, you know, that two people have as to, I will do this, and I will expect this from you. Now, the expectation will be based on doing the things that have been promised. So until one person has fulfilled what his own part, he cannot be expecting from the other side. And so God decided to give to us what will be a condition to what, you know, we guarantee the blessing that, you know, we expect from him. And that was in the first statement in that passage. Thou shalt serve the Lord. Now, the part that God demands from us is a service unto him. And if we can only keep that part, we will get everything that God wants to give to us. And so this night, I want to begin by talking about the covenant of circumcision. Now, because if we don't take it from where we're supposed to start from, we can't jump the gun. Or else you discover that we won't be able to get to the root. But as quickly as we can go this night, as we lay the foundation, I believe God that he will grant us the understanding. In Deuteronomy, in chapter 7, when you read verse 8 and 9, God showed to us the reason why he make a demand for covenant, and that is because of love. Now, so circumcision, on the other hand, has something to do with how much of love that we want to show or exhibit unto the Most High God. So if you go with me to Genesis 17, and I'll read from verse 1. He said, and when Abraham was 90 years old and nine, the Lord appeared unto Abraham and said unto him, I am the Almighty God. Walk before me and be thou perfect, and I will make my covenant between me and thee, and I will multiply thee exceedingly. And Abraham fell on his face, and God talked with him, saying, as for me, behold, my covenant is with thee, and thou shalt be a father of many nations. Neither shall thy seed, thy name, any more be called Abram, but thy name shall be Abraham, for a father of many nations have I made thee. And I will make thee exceedingly fruitful, and I will make nation out of thee, and kings shall come out of thee. And I will establish my covenant between me and thee and thy seed after thee in their generation for an everlasting covenant to be a God unto thee and to thy seed after thee. And I will give unto thee and thy seed after thee the land wherein thou art a stranger, and all the land of Canaan for the everlasting possession, and I will be their God. Hallelujah. Now, the passage we've just read shows God coming back to Abraham after a long time of waiting in the life of Abraham. When God called Abraham, he was 75 years old. When God came back to him, he was 99 years. 24 years after God has made a promise, God came back to him to say, as for me, my covenant is with you. Now, what prompted this war? If you go back to chapter 16, you have found out, you will discover that Abraham has discovered to go in his own way, to do things different from what God has planned. He has decided to walk in his own way, to help himself, so to say. Say, well, if God will not do what he promised to do, let me help myself. As a matter of fact, heaven helps those who help themselves, just like many people will say today. And so he decided to help himself out. And for 13 years, heavens was closed over him. And so God returned to him in chapter 17 to say, if you can only walk before me and be perfect, Everything that I have said, I will do. Not only that, I'm going to make a change in your name. You're not just going to be a prince, but a father of nations. And I will be a God unto you and to your children and to your children's children in their generation. And the land whereon your children were stranger, I'm going to give them for possession. Based on the fact that you will walk before me and you will be perfect. And then in verse 10, he brought out what will be the physical show, so to say, of the covenant token between himself and Abraham. That this is my covenant which ye shall keep between me and you and thy seed after thee. Every man-child among you shall be circumcised. Why does God demand for circumcision of all the male child, beginning with Abraham himself? Because as we read further, you discover that the man has to be circumcised. Number one is that which make a man, that was what makes a man. And so that is where God wants to touch. That I am in control in this aspect of your life. Man is the seed producer and the seed carrier. It is from him that seed is transferred. And so the process or the channel through which the seed of reproduction or greatness will come also has to be touched. Now, everything that makes the man, you know, God decided to touch the man where he will feel the thing very well. And so he said to Abraham, it will not just end with you, but your children after you and your children's children. It will be a covenant that everybody must ask to keep. As a matter of fact, he said to him, anyone who will break that cycle should be terminated. Because this covenant will be something that will connect all your children to that which I have said. Now, it was between God and Abraham. But for the children of Abraham to enjoy all the things that God has said, they must be connected one way or the other. And the sign of connection is this, is that circumcision that God demanded from them. So circumcision that God demanded from them was to take something physically from them that will turn around, that will make their life that it depends on God. That will take them to the place where they will also totally and completely depend on the Most High. He wants to show what exactly they are willing to sacrifice. God owns the earth and the fullness thereof, according to Psalm 24, verse 1. Now, he wants to give it to him, but he wants to say, if I'm giving you my treasure, I need something that worth the same quality from you in order to trade, you know, to have a trade in between us. And so this became necessity. I'm sure you know that God is the creator. God is the keeper, or, you know, is the originator of all things. And so the covenant is asking for is something that commits man unto God. Something that commits man unto God. And that will make God to remain committed unto man. I need to say, covenant is the basis of God's relationship with all his creature. Man at every level, what determine which side of God you see is determined by the covenant of God that you are into. In Psalm 50, in verse 5, God, the word of the Lord says, gather my saints together unto me, those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. Gather my saints together unto me, those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. So, sacrifice is that which we offered unto the Lord, and that which bring the enjoyment, you know, unto our life. Why sacrifice? Or why covenant? Every relationship is based on covenant. Circumcision, you know, take us to depend on God and to connect with God. It shows what man is willing to sacrifice in order to get all the blessing of the Almighty God. And the covenant of circumcision is that which caused the flow of the blessing that God pronounced unto Abraham to be channeled into the life of a man. And I want you to understand one thing. Most of the time when God makes his commandments, they are difficult for us to understand. And most of them cannot just be taken literally, because a number of them signifies some deep spiritual thing, or have deep spiritual meaning. And until we have the understanding of those deep spiritual meaning and apply them, we don't really enjoy all the blessing. For example, in Exodus chapter 30, when you read from verse 7 to 8, Exodus 30, 7 to 8, God said to Aaron, each time they want to worship in the tabernacle, now they must bring an incense. And there must always be incense in his presence that must be offered. Now, what important is incense is of no significance. But by the time we move on, many years later, God gave a revelation of why or what that incense represents. In Psalm 141 in verse 2, Psalm 141 verse 2, David, the psalmist says, let my prayer be set before you as incense, the lifting up of my head as the evening sacrifice. Now, the house of God, Jesus said, is a house of prayer. And so one thing that God wants to get from there on a regular basis that monosis is prayer. But when he was talking to them in the Old Testament, he talks about incense, but not incense that is of any importance as far as God is concerned. But that was just an ordinance that God wants them to create. So in today's world, you don't need any incense, or we don't need to make any incense in the tabernacle. What is it that God expects? Fervent prayer. Because the prayer we offer, the prayer of the saint, is the incense that arises to the presence of God on a regular basis. So when God asked Abraham to circumcise his foreskin, of what importance is this unto God? Or what exactly is the meaning of this sacrifice? Or what spiritual implication does this have? Now, we may not really understand until much later in the journey of the children of Israel that we discover. Leviticus 26, as you read from verse 40 to 42. Leviticus 26, from verse 40 to 42. The circumcision that God is talking about is about the confession of the iniquity. He said, but if they confess their iniquity and the iniquity of their fathers, which they are with their unfaithfulness, in which they were unfaithful to me, and that they also have walked contrary to me, and that I also have walked contrary to them, and have brought them on into the land of their enemy. If their uncircumcised hearts are humbled, and they accept their guilt, then I will remember my covenant with Jacob, and my covenant with Isaac, and my covenant with Abraham. I will remember, and I will remember the land. In the physical sense, God asked for the cutting off of their foreskin. But by spiritual implication, God actually needed the hearts of men to be circumcised. Because until the heart is circumcised, that's why you find out in many passages, as the children of Israel were traveling to the promised land, now he asked to make this wall. In Deuteronomy chapter 10 in verse 16, he repeated the same thing. When he wants to talk about their stubbornness to his commandment, he said, therefore, circumcise the foreskin of your heart and be still naked no longer. Circumcise the foreskin of your heart. Now there are physical things that is done that the eyes of many people see that we do. But there are hidden things that the eyes of men cannot see that God is placing a demand on that determines our blessing. Amen. Until you are willing to have a total turn around, to live in total and complete obedience to the word of God, certain things will not come to manifestation in our life. In order for God to make the blessing that he has promised our father come into our life, in Deuteronomy chapter 13 verse 6, he said, and the Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the hearts of your descendants to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, that you may live. Why will God demand for circumcision? That we may love the Lord with all our heart, with all our soul, and with all our mind. So that tells us something about circumcision. Circumcision is a token of friendship. Something that shows that we are a friend of God. We have entered into relationship. What shows our relationship with our Maker. God demands such a great, you know, sacrifice that the world will see. Not on physical things to show, but that which will be the hidden man of the heart that will reflect to our generation. Circumcision refers to spiritual work that is done in our heart by the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and enable us to turn in God in total obedience, and that makes the word of God convenient and applicable in our life. And when that happened, he said, we will enjoy all the blessing. Circumcision is all about showing that we are a friend and we are willing to sacrifice something for the one that we love. We have called a friendship that we will never betray ourselves. A number of things in the realm of the spirit are taken in demonic people, hijack them and they practice it. Now, when you see people who said they want to show themselves that they are friend, and they said they want to make covenant, they will not betray themselves, and they begin to either eat some things together or cut themselves, touch their own blood as a mark of I will never betray you. And most of the time when they are doing it, they do it with an oath. If I ever betray you, let this or this happen to me. But you see, the God of covenant who gave us this one is to show that our hearts, if it is taken by God, every other thing that we have is taken by God. One thing we must get right. One aspect of your life that God is looking for is your heart. If God could have the heart, he takes control of every other part. Because out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth will speak. If he owns your heart, he will control your word. If he owns your heart, he will control your action. If he owns your heart, he will control all your reaction. If he owns your heart, he will take control of your emotion. If he takes care of your heart, he will take care of, your thought life. There is one thing that God is asking of you today, and that we, each one of us, must give unto the Lord as a sign of devotion unto God. God said to Abraham, there is one thing you must give to me to show that you really want to be a friend of me. Circumcise yourself, and all your children must be circumcised. And there is one thing that God is asking of you to say, in order for you to show yourself my friend, you must give me your heart. The question each one of us must ask ourselves is, have I given my heart unto the Lord? Have I given my heart unto the Lord? Because if you give your heart unto the Lord, every word of the Lord will be convenient for you to carry. Every instruction of God will be convenient for you to obey. Every word of God will be convenient for you to live by. And God is saying something, give your heart unto me. Until your heart is given unto God, the Adamic nature will not be dealt with. And until the Adamic nature is dealt with, the flow of God's blessing cannot come into your life. You cannot be spiritual until the Adamic nature has been dealt with. Until the Adamic nature is dealt with, sin will still be found appealing and interesting, and there will still be, secret desire for sin. There are many people who are not into sin physically, but their heart is lusting into sin. And you know what? Jesus said, even if you have not done it, but your heart has done it, he said, you are guilty already. The Adamic nature is the first thing that must be dealt with so that can be removed. So the evidence of the circumcision of the earth is that the things of God now lives in your heart. How much of God you are able to contain, how much of the word of God that you are able to abide with, how much of the will of God you are able to walk with, and how much of the instruction of God you are willing to walk by. Many of us want God to do so much for us, but we are not willing to do anything for him. As we lay the foundation this night, the first question you must be able to answer to yourself How much will I be willing to do for God? How far will I be willing to go for God? How deep will I be willing to go for God? To which extent will I be willing to move with God? And until God knows you are willing to go with him all the way, he will be with you all the way. And he will prove himself in your life. In the mighty name of Jesus. But one thing that must get behind the mind of each one of us, that if you say, I will go with you all the way, our love for the Lord will be tested and proved. Not until then, we can't see the manifestation of the power of God. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, in Daniel chapter 3, proved that they were willing to go with God all the way. And God also proved himself that he can be with a man all the way, even in the midst of the fiery furnace, that God was with them. Daniel proved his love, that he was willing to forgo every other thing, but to go with the Lord. God also proved himself by going with him, even into the lion's den. He was the first and only person that ever entered into the lion's den and returned alive. The only one who could tell us the real way the lions live, what happened in their kingdom. And he lived to tell the story. How far are you willing to go until the heart is circumcised? It will be difficult to live a holy life. And God want to bless people, and in this time, in this our dispensation, in order to showcase them as a symbol of righteousness and holiness, as a symbol of purity. If you are willing to stand for the Lord, God is also willing to stand by you. I want to say to us this evening, for your worship to be acceptable unto the Lord, God has to take control of your heart. And when your heart is with him, when he has control of your heart, definitely everything about your life will be in his hand. Paul in Philippians chapter 3, verse 3 says, but we are the circumcision that worship the Lord, not physically, but also spiritually. God is looking for people who will give true worship, who will not have confidence in the flesh, but their strength and confidence will be in the spirit. People who will humble themselves with God and who will allow the hand of God to carry them. People who will show their love unto the Lord in every regard and in every aspect of life, and God also will prove himself in their life in every regard. Tonight is a night of examination. And the examination is not examination that anybody is setting for you. It's an examination that each one of us will set for ourselves. God wants to take the heart if you are willing to give it unto him. Whatever things that touches your heart or take control of your heart, take controls of your life. As we'll be praying this night, it is primarily to give God our hearts and ask him to take it over. And then to make a solemn promise for the Lord this night, upon which what he will pour upon us will be based upon. But one truth that each one of us must know is this: Now, God is not only interested in your word, he knows the position of your heart. So it is not only what you say that God is counting on, but whether it comes from your heart or just a lip service. Tonight, my prayer is that each one of us will reconcile with the Lord totally and completely, and we will get the best that God wants to give to us. In the mighty name of Jesus. Tonight, what God is doing with us was what he did with his children in Joshua chapter 5. At the time they were getting onto the verge of the promised land, it demanded that they be circumcised so that the reproach of Egypt can be taken away from them. Tonight, God is taking each one of us to Gilgal, where the reproach must be taken away. And until we have this experience of circumcision of our heart, we will not cross over onto the other side of Jordan. We are at the verge of Jordan, where all the promise of God will come to manifestation. But how much you will get depend on what decision you make with the Lord. Let's rise to our feet.